What a glorious time of the year to be with everybody. The festival of Purim is upon us. And some of you might be saying, I thought Purim was on Thursday. Clearly, you've never celebrated Purim in Israel. Purim is like a week-long celebration, unofficially. It's a lot of fun, Baruch Hashem. But this is also the time for preparing for Pesach and for getting our homes, starting the process of removing the leaven from our homes, and not just from our homes, but also from our hearts as well. And so just as a point of practical advice, and by the way, we had a little sheet that we printed out to help people, practical guide for chametz cleaning, and what exactly is chametz. It's a commandment to get it out, but what exactly is it? But as another practical note, this is not, you know, you probably want to refrain from buying anything, any kind of packaged good or boxed good that is not certified kosher for Pesach. And it will actually say on the box, it'll have a kosher, near the kosher emblem, it will say kosher for Passover. So if you're buying a box of cereal, it needs to say kosher for Passover. Because otherwise, you might buy something and then you end up having to give it away or throw it out or something like that. So I also want to make you aware of the fact that at this moment, the Tom Thumbs in Dallas, both of them on Campbell and on Preston and Forest, and also the Tom Thumb on Hewlin Street in South Fort Worth, have large Pesach sections. The one on Hewlin in Fort Worth is in the back of the store, right around where the dairy area and all that kind of stuff is. And then Tom Thumb, the one in Dallas, anywhere on Forest and Preston, it's at the front of the store. But they're huge sections. Okay, we know this. We're experts. We're highly trained to know these things. And so just know that whatever you buy from now on in a package, now if it's fresh fruit or vegetables and like that, don't worry about it. But otherwise, I'd say this is practical because you don't want to throw out the 50-pound sack of waffle fixings, right? Baruch Hashem. I also want to mention something else. I had forgotten that the Brit HaDashah reading today was talking about Messiah multiplying the fishes and loaves. So we've had the blessing this week on two occasions, last night and also on Wednesday night, to have a teaching seder here for EVC. We had it right here. It's wonderful. So on Wednesday night, there was somewhere around 130 people. Last night, I think it was pushing maybe 200. It was getting close to that number. I'm not sure exactly sure what the number was. So the cool thing was is that, as happens in our seder, we pull out we have the afikomen, and we would want everybody to take just a little piece of the afikomen, so everybody would get a piece of the actual afikomen that was found. And of course, me, the man of great faith, I was thinking this is never going to happen. But did you know in both seders, everybody in the room got a little piece of that little afikomen? Wow. Hashem really did multiply the loaf. Yeah. Baruch Hashem, we didn't have any fish, but hallelujah. That's just neat. It's neat. Baruch Hashem. Parashat Tzav. Let's open our Bibles up again to the book of Vayikra, the book of Leviticus. Let's begin to look at this. We're going to look at the first six verses of Parashat Tzav. It's chapter 6, beginning in verse 1. Tzav is the Hebrew word that means command. As you know, as you may or may not know, the different parashot, which means portions in Hebrew, were given to us originally by Ezra and Nehemiah. They've been modified, so to speak, as far as how they are done each week since that time. But originally, Ezra and Nehemiah gave us the various Torah portions. And it's worth stating, by the way, that the reason they did so is because they had just returned from the captivity of Babylon. They had just returned from exile. Is it popping all of a sudden? It was fine, wasn't it? All right, we'll try it for a second. If not, I'll switch. Of course, that microphone is having issues too. I'm starting to love microphones. Baruch Hashem. I love them. I love them. I love them. Anyway, it's the anointing. So they returned from the Babylonian captivity, and they realized the reason that they had gone into captivity was precisely because they had forgotten, or they chose not to follow the Torah of Adonai. They lost track of it. They just completely forgot it. And God had promised, listen, if you stop obeying my word, it's not going to work out well for you. So when Ezra and Nehemiah returned to the land, they said, you know, we're going to make sure that this doesn't happen again. And so they instituted a reading schedule called the Parashot, whereby Israel would intensely study week by week the Torah so that in a year's time, we would go through all five books of the Torah, most of the prophets, and for us who believe in Messiah Yeshua, we add gospel readings as well. But the point is to keep us focused on the Word, because what happens if you lose sight of the Word of God? The Word of God is our compass. I've used this analogy before, but it's worth repeating, that when you're on a boat in the ocean, especially at nighttime, you're out there and you have no point of no reference. You say you can be guided by the stars, like, yeah, you could, but you know, if it's a starry night. But you're out there on the open ocean, there's no point of reference, and so you have this little compass on your boat, and you know the direction you're trying to go. And so you don't really have to so much worry about what's in front of you, because there's nothing out there but water. So you focus on the compass. Because as long as you're keeping that little glowing green light on the compass point, you're going to make it to where you're going. But the reality of navigation is that if you get off even a fraction of a degree, you think, well, I'm not off that much. You know, it doesn't really matter that much. But in the grand scheme of things, if you look at a map, if you're off by a fraction of a degree, you could miss your shoreline by 1,000 miles. So being a little bit off the mark now could mean that you're way off course down the road. So the point is that the Word of God, the Torah, is our compass, and we've got to stay focused on it. So we have Parashat Tzav, which is the second parashah of the book of Leviticus, which means command. And the word Tzav, the rabbis understood that to mean that this command is an imperative. We are supposed to understand that what he's telling us here is for us right now and for future generations. So let's pray and ask the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, to open up the mind of our understanding so that we can really acquire Torah this morning. Hashem, we praise you for your word. We thank you, Adonai, for your illumination. We thank you for your love that you've given us, that you've loved us so much, that you give us your precious Torah, that you've redeemed us, that you've given us the opportunity to accept again your covenant on the earth. Today, Father, may the words of my mouth and meditations of my heart be pleasing before you. May it be your will, Hashem, my God and God of my forefathers, that we would all leave here transformed, and that you would take information and turn it into illumination in Yeshua's name. Amen. So let's look again at this Torah portion. This is probably one of the most important passages in the entire scripture, what we're about to read. We read it in the Hebrew earlier. Actually, Reuven read it, did an excellent job. Verse 1 says, Hashem spoke to Moses saying, command Aaron. Say command.
Command.
Command. So right there, this is not optional. The word of God are made up of commandments, not suggestions. Right? They're commandments. How many of you know it doesn't matter if we understand them? Right? It doesn't matter if they make sense to us. How many of you know it doesn't matter if it works okay in our life or not? Right? God, I can't do your word. I can't do your word because it doesn't fit my schedule. I can't do your word because, you know, this is not who I am. I'm Irish, you know, right? Or whatever. I'm French. Le fatu, okay? So these are commandments. Command Aaron and his son saying, this is the law. That word law in Hebrew is Torah. This is the Torah. B'nei le'mor zot Torah t'ha'ola. This is the Torah of the burnt offering. That is, burnt offering literally is elevation offering. Now, the word for offering or sacrifice in Hebrew is completely different than what it is in the English language. We think of sacrifice, that is, we're giving up something. And typically we think of it as we've got to appease an angry God. So we're going to give up something, kind of like throwing the virgin into the volcano, right? We're giving up something to appease an angry God. But that's not what the Hebrew word for offering means. The Hebrew word for offering is korban, and it literally means to elevate. I think it was Mikael who was exhorting us earlier and saying that we've got there might be clouds, there might be a cloudy day in our life, but the issue is we've just got to elevate higher, because the fact of the matter is even though there's an overcast, the sun is still up there. Light is still shining. We just got to elevate above the clouds. Now, how many of you have been on an airplane and it's been a little stormy outside? My wife loves that. She loves to take off in a stormy weather. No, she doesn't. My wife is precious. We're flying and it's a little cloudy outside, a little stormy. And she'll say, I need you to pray. And I would say, okay, well, Hashem, we just pray for this flight. No. I need you to pray. Like, for real. Like, act like you mean it. So, but as you're going up, you're going past all the clouds and all the storm. Next thing you know, you're above the clouds and it's beautiful out. So how is it that we elevate in our life? How do we elevate above the storm clouds? And the answer is the carbon. The sacrifice. That's how we elevate. And the highest form of offering elevation was the Korban Olah, the elevation offering, where we would come and put the animal on the altar, and there was no benefit to us or to the priesthood for that matter. I mean, you think about that. You bring your lamb or your bull, and you bring it to the altar to give it. Now think, in those days, of course, the lamb or the bull had to be perfect. It had to be a show lamb or show bull, right? Or ram or what have you. Or a goat, for that matter. But it had to be perfect. It had to be your best one. And in an agricultural society, that's money. This is why the ancient sages said that one of the reasons why Hashem told Aaron, he said, command Aaron. One of the reasons he was saying that is because, least, God forbid, the priesthood should not take the olah offering seriously or not consider the heart of the one who's giving it, because, you know, it's not their lamb. They're facilitating the olah offering, but nothing came out of their pocket. Judaism takes seriously business dealings. In fact, the question that's asked, according to the sages, according to ancient Israel, the first question that's asked when you get to the Olam Haba, the first question that's asked at your court hearing, and everybody's going to have one, and that is, did you deal honestly in business? Now think about that for a minute. Most people, when I tell them that, they're like, what? That's going to be Hashem's first question? Sure it is. Why? Because people go out and they sacrifice for their families. Husbands go out, sometimes wives go out, and they work hard, and they're putting up with a whole bunch of mess so they can feed their kids, and they're feeding their family, and they're providing a roof for their family. And then they go out and they need to buy something, and they come to you to do business, and you cheat them. You're cheating them not out of, you say, well, I'm just cheating out of a few dollars. No, you're not. You're cheating them out of their blood, sweat, and tears. You are taking literally from them. And so when we deal dishonestly in business, then that we're judged harshly for that, because it's not just cold cash we're talking about. It's about human life. So the commandment to the priest is look, listen, this person is coming. It's the olah offering, by the way, is totally volunteer. Everybody thinks, or not everybody thinks, but a lot of people think that the sacrificial system was all about sin. No, it wasn't. That was only a small fraction of it. Most of the offerings that were brought to the temple were completely voluntary, and they were completely done out of a heart of love and a desire simply to come into the house. I just want to come into Dad's house. I just want to hang out in the house today. And I got to have a reason to go, so I'm going to bring an offering. And by the way, you got to go into your flock and find the best one and bring it. But it's all voluntary. And so here comes that person with that lamb or that goat. And this is their prize one. And all of it's going to go on the altar. There's no benefit. See, normally with a sin offering, with a sin offering and with a peace offering, the priest and the person who brought the offering, they get to eat of it. This is why Messiah said, unless you eat my flesh. He wasn't speaking literally. He was saying, I'm your sin offering. I'm your peace offering. And unless you eat of my flesh, and by the way, you got to eat, in order to eat the flesh, according to the word of God, you got to eat the flesh in a purified state. You can't eat of the flesh if you're not purified. And you got to eat of the flesh in a purified place. And the purified place, by the way, was Jerusalem, the vicinity of Jerusalem. So you bring the offering, and the commandment to the priest was, look, this is not your lamb, it's not money out of your pocket, but you better respect it as if it was yours. Because that person is giving everything to me. And it's all going up in smoke. But it's drawing them into my presence. It's elevating them above their circumstance. It's elevating them into my kingdom, my throne room, so to speak. Isn't it interesting that Yeshua is the ultimate Korban Olah? He's the elevation offering. He made a sacrifice for us not to appease an angry God, but to allow us to get into the presence of God. He made a way. See, because God said, listen, you've got to get to the seventh heaven, the highest level of heaven. And the deal is you don't have an offering that valuable. And because you don't have an offering that valuable, I'm going to provide one that's above anything you could ever provide me. So that we could get into his throne room. So it continues on, and it says, this is the law of the burnt offering. It's the burnt offering of the flame rather, on the altar, all night until the morning. And the fire of the altar should be kept aflame on it. The fire of the altar should be kept aflame. Say, keep it aflame. That's one of the most important verses in the entire Bible that we need to keep in our heart. To keep the flame on it. The Kohen, that is the priest, shall don his fitted linen garment, and he shall don linen breeches on his flesh, and he shall separate the ash of what the fire consumed of the burnt offering on the altar, and place it next to the altar. And he shall remove his garments and don the other garments, and he shall remove the ash to the outside of the camp to a pure place. The fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. It shall not be extinguished. Say, don't let it go out. And the Kohen shall kindle wood upon it every morning. Say, every morning. Every morning you got to put wood on the altar. You got to put fuel on the altar. You know, most of the time, or I should say, let me say this. When we are going through life and we reach those points where we say, I just don't feel the fire in my soul right now. If we will be honest with ourselves and analyze our life, we'll find that we haven't really been putting fuel on the fire. Because if you're getting up every morning and you're davening, and if every day you're studying the Torah, and if every day you're seeking after Hashem through mitzvot and so on, that fire can't go out. How can you study the scripture? How can you stand before the living God and pray? How can you do the will of God through mitzvot and the fire goes out? How is that possible? It's not possible. If we do an analysis of our life, if we're honest with ourselves, we would say, well, we've skipped some mornings. We didn't put fuel on the fire. Sometimes you got to stoke the fire. Someone say, well, my fire has been going out, so I've stopped coming to synagogue regular. That's the worst thing you can do. That's the worst thing you can do. Because how many of you know if you got a fire going, if you've been camping or anything like that, if your fire starts going out, you take the little rod or the stick or whatever, and you move some logs around, all of a sudden the fire goes up again. When you come to synagogue, you bump into people, and that's moving your log around and letting the fire come out. You stay home, guess what happens? You know, it reminds me of a story that I've told before. The story of a man who stopped coming to the congregation. And after a while, the rabbi noticed that he wasn't coming to the congregation. And so he got concerned about him, and he paid a house visit to him. And it was a cold winter day, and he went in, and the man had a blazing fire going in the fireplace, and the man greeted the rabbi, and they sat in the front room and fixed him a cup of tea. And they just chatted and talking about different things, and he just let him know, "I was concerned about you, so I wanted to see you. Well, my life this, my life that. This got going on, so-and-so, so-and-so, you know. This schedule came up." And the rabbi just was poking around in the fire, and he took a set of tongs, and he grabbed one of the coals, and he just laid it out by itself on the brick. And he continued talking to the man. And they just continued to talk about nothing. And they sipped his tea, and when the rabbi had finished his tea, the man looked over at that coal, and it had been blazing hot when the rabbi took it out and set it on the brick, and now it was just cold and black. The man stood up with the rabbi, showed him to the door. With tears in his eyes, he said, "Rabbi, I want to thank you for giving me the best sermon you could ever give me in your entire life. I'll see you at Shabbat at Shul." We have to understand that we're blazing hot coal right now, but the enemy wants to get us away. Like we talked about the dogs of Africa. He's just luring us out. He wants you to stop praying. He wants you to stop keeping the mitzvot. He wants you to stop coming to Shul. He wants you to stop putting wood on the fire. But we're commanded to keep the fire burning and to put wood on the fire. Every morning, it says. Not to skip a day. Every morning. "He shall prepare the burnt offering upon it and shall cause the fat of the peace offering to go up in smoke upon it." A permanent fire. Say permanent fire. "A permanent fire shall remain a flame on the altar. It shall not be extinguished." Now, Rabbi Shlomo Carlebach was, whenever he was in the midst of a teaching in a class, or he was leading a prayer service, or perhaps he was performing at a concert, whenever he felt that the congregation or the audience was lacking enthusiasm, he would abruptly stop and plead with everyone, and he would cry out, "More fire, more fire." Why did he do that? Well, the word fire is actually equivalent with joy. Joy, simcha, begins with a sheen, and the letter sheen is indicative of fire, which is in Hebrew, aleph sheen, esh. In fact, let's look at the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 47. The scripture there says, "Because you did not serve the Lord your God joyfully and gladly in the time of prosperity." You could read that in the Hebrew and say, "Because you did not serve the Lord your God with fire." With fire, with enthusiasm. You know, oftentimes we pray to God and we say, "God, I want you to light the fire in my life." And God says, "I'm waiting for you to throw wood on the fire. I'm waiting for you to light it up." See, we don't understand that we come to synagogue, we are a bunch of lapidim, we're a bunch of torches, and we come together and we make a great bonfire. Now, it's true that our fire may be going out and we need to come and have somebody else light our fire. That's entirely appropriate, but too often we depend on someone else or even Hashem himself to light the fire. And God is saying to us, "I lit your fire. The problem is you won't keep it going." I know this is uncomfortable. We always want everything to be somebody else's fault, right? It's God's fault. It's my boss's fault. It's my husband's fault. My wife's fault. My dog's fault. My cat's fault. Sometimes it is the cat's fault. Yeah. I have a love-hate relationship with my cat. Interestingly, the word for holy, kodesh, is a combination of two words, which is yikod esh, which means ignite the fire. Wow. Let me say that again. The word holy, kodesh, is a combination of yikod esh, which means ignite the fire. If you want to be holy, you got to ignite the fire. How do you purify something? You burn it up. You apply fire to it. If it can't literally take fire, then you pour boiling water on it. The Midrash Rabbah this week says that God wanted to purify Sodom and Gomorrah. So every drop of rain that he caused to fall down on Sodom and Gomorrah, he had first boiled it in Gehinnom. We are called, the Midrash Rabbah, and actually Rambam brings down that we're supposed to, we ourselves are supposed to be a burning bush for Hashem. So let's look at the Midrash Rabbah before we go there, because I want to talk about the burning bush in just a second, but I want to read something right quick. The Midrash Rabbah, on this, commenting on this topic, on this verse, specifically chapter 6 and verse 2, it says, "Command Aaron and his sons, saying, this is the law of the burnt offering." Excuse me one second. There's a line there of... Gotta love technology. "Command Aaron and his sons, saying, this is the law of the burnt offering. That which Scripture states, enmity arouses strife, but love covers all offenses." Proverbs 10:12. It says here, the enmity that the nation of Israel placed between themselves and their Father in heaven is what aroused God's severe judgment against them. As Rabbi Shmuel Bar Nachman said, "For nearly 900 years, the older enmity between the nation of Israel and their Father in heaven was dormant. From the day that Israel left Egypt until the time that it became aroused again in the days of Ezekiel. Thus it is written in Ezekiel, 'Thus said the Lord Adonai Elohim, on that day I chose Israel, and I said to them, every man cast away the detestable idols of his eyes. Do not defile yourselves with the idols of Egypt. I am Adonai your God.' Ezekiel 20:5-7. But the Israelites did not do so. They rebelled against me and did not want to listen to me. No man of them cast away detestable idols from their eyes, and they did not forsake the idols of Egypt. But, it says, God continued, 'I acted with the Israelites for the sake of my great name, refraining from punishing them so that my name would not be desecrated. As the Scripture states, I acted for the sake of my name, that it not be desecrated in the eyes of the nations, in whose midst they were, before whose eyes I made myself known to them, promising to take them out of the land of Egypt.'" So it says here that when they came out of Egypt, they were all idolaters. They had been worshiping idols in Egypt. That's why everybody had to come to Mount Sinai and go through conversion. Every Hebrew person had to go through conversion at Mount Sinai because they were worshiping idols in Egypt. But God did not hold that against them for the sake of His great name. For the sake of His great name. You say, why doesn't God punish the wicked? Could be for the sake of His great name. He doesn't want to punish His people, lest people should say, you can't save your own people. But the Midrash Rabbah says, "But love covers all offenses," referring to the love with which the omnipresent loved the nation of Israel, as the Scripture says, "I loved you, says Adonai," Malachi 1:2. So the question is, He loved them, so He didn't punish them because of His love. He overlooked their iniquity for the sake of His great love for them. But why is it then that He punished our forefathers with the destruction of the temple later at the Babylonian exile? And the reason is because He had forgiven them of their idolatry through His great love. But when they came into the land, they began to sin again. And so the Midrash Rabbah is bringing out a teaching and saying, when God has forgiven us through His great love and for His name's sake, and then we come in and we're all forgiven and everything's glorious, and then we forget His word and begin to sin again, He not only remembers those sins we just did, but He goes back and looks at those original sins and says, you know what? I wiped the slate clean, but guess what? You brought the case back up again. You say, well, Rabbi, doesn't God forgive and forget? Yes, unless we forget. In which case, He goes back and says, let's see. No, look, this is just normal. If you're in a regular court and the judge, you come before the judge and he says, you know what, I see that this is your first offense and, you know, you were smoking crack, not thinking. So therefore, I choose to forgive you. We're gonna wipe this out. You go out there and don't do this again. Okay? And you're like, all right. You go out there and you do something stupid again. You come back for the judge. You think, what do you think he's going to say? He's going to say, didn't I forgive you of that charge? What do you think? You think he's just going to go, well, I'm going to pretend like you didn't do anything before. No. He's going to say, you've been forgiven once. And now you're going to be punished for this one. And let's go ahead and revisit this other one. Because obviously, you say, well, that doesn't sound like a loving God. No, wait. Whose fault is it? He said, that ain't fair, God. You can't bring up my past sins. He said, I didn't. You did.
Yeah.
See, the whole thing, right, stay out the courtroom, Mazel said. Like the commentary says here, their idol worship in Egypt was aroused again by their renewed sinning. This is why we have to have a righteousness conscience. This is why following the mitzvot is so important. Following the commandments is so important. Because it keeps us on a path. If you wake up and you're thinking about what's God's will for my life, what does He want me to literally eat? How does He want me to dress? How does He want me to act? How does He want me to pray? What does He want me to pray? If you're focused on that, you don't get blindsided by all the other stuff. But you wake up and you haven't the foggiest idea. You walk into the grocery store and everything there you can have. Who takes their little kid to the restaurant and says, eat whatever you want? You want something from the bar? Go get something from the bar. You want dessert first? Hey, man, why go get the sandwich or the free ice cream? Just go get the free ice cream. What parent does that? If you did that today, they would be doing this to you. Watch your head. CPS would be showing up at your house. And God does that to us. He doesn't leave us in the world without any direction. He takes us to the world and says, now listen, you can do that. I mean, you can do that. You have the freedom to do that. However, when you choose to do that with your blessed freedom, it's not going to work out so well for you. So I'm going to tell you, do that. Right? Little Johnny says, I want a hot dog for dinner. No, tonight we're having, you know, whatever, something healthy. I don't want that. But you're going to be very hungry. Obviously, this is a fast day. You've chosen a fast. Here's the sitter. There's fasting prayers in there. Go to your room and pray. That's how my parents were. My mother fixed the dinner, and I look at that and say, I don't want that. See, my brother and I were not picky eaters. Because I think we might have tried it once. I don't remember if we did, but my mother set a plate down. We kind of looked at it crossways. My mother said, psh. Okay. You can talk about wrath of Gehenna. Anyway. So the Midrash Rabbah continues on this topic. And talking about Aaron. Interesting insight about Aaron. God was angry at Aaron, but according to the Midrash Rabbah, remember Aaron helped in making the golden calf. And God was angry with Aaron, but it's an interesting insight about why the Midrash Rabbah is saying that God was angry with Aaron. Because according to the Midrash Rabbah, Aaron had taken a hammer to the golden calf and he had banged on the nose of it, disfigured it a little bit. In order to show the children of Israel that this is really nothing. Y'all are praying to it, but it's just a piece of metal. And God got angry at Aaron and said, this is why Moshe, by the way, had said, what is this that you have done? Because up until that time, the children of Israel were acting in ignorance. They were looking at the golden calf, and they were saying that we're not believing that this is a different deity. It's just that this is how we're used to worshiping the Most High God, so we're going to worship Him in this manner. Now you say, where does that come from? It comes from the Scripture. Because Aaron said, This is a festival to Hashem at the golden calf. See, many people think it's okay to worship God anyway, and you can worship God the way the nations worship God. You can even have an idol like the nations have, because really all that matters is that you're directing your heart to God, right? But that's not true. The problem with that is the scripture. The problem with that is that God explicitly says that, yes, your heart matters as long as you're doing what I tell you to do, right? You know, if your son steals your car, but he brings your wife flowers, does that make it okay? Why'd you steal my car? Well, I wanted to go buy mom flowers. Oh, that's fine. Your heart was in the right place. No, I don't think so. Anyway. So God wanted to kill Aaron. And Moshe prayed for him, and because it says here, the prayer of Moshe, but love covers all offenses. Love refers to the prayer that Moses prayed on Aaron's behalf. And what prayer did Moses pray? Rabbi Manna said this, from the beginning of the book of Leviticus until now it is written, the sons of Aaron, the Kohanim, shall arrange pieces, the head and the fats on the wood. That is, they're going to tend the altar. And the sons of Aaron the Kohanim shall throw its blood on the altar. The sons of Aaron the Kohanim shall place fire on the altar. So Moses said before the Holy One, blessed is he, the cistern is hated, and yet its waters are cherished. In other words, you don't like Aaron, but you're commanding his son to do certain things. If the cistern is hated, shouldn't the water that comes out of the cistern also be hated? Additionally, he said, you confer honor on the trees according to their offspring, as it is taught in the Mishnah. The wood from all the trees is valid for the altar, except for that of the olive tree and the grapevine. And the reason for that is because you want the olive tree to continue to produce olives, and the grapevine to continue to produce grapes. I thought that was a beautiful insight. King David prayed this prayer. The Midrash Rabbah talks about Psalm 51, talking about keep the fire burning. It says, the sacrifices God desires are a broken spirit, a broken heart, and a humbled heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good in your favor unto Zion, and build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will desire the offspring of the righteousness, burnt offerings and whole offerings. Then will bulls go up on your altar. Psalm 51, 19 through 21. The rabbis were talking about this famous prayer from King David. And remember, this prayer happened after King David's sin of Bathsheba had been found out. And his fear was that now that he sinned and he had Uriah killed, that his son Solomon would no longer be able to build the temple. He saw what happened to Saul. Remember, Saul's kingdom was lost because Saul broke the commandments of God. And King David was so scared. But the problem was that in Saul's day, when Saul broke the commandments, he came up with all kinds of excuses. Well, the reason I didn't do the will of God is because the people were mad at me, or I was concerned about this or this. When David found out that he had broken the will of God, he knew he had broken the will of God. But when he was confronted with it, he didn't make any excuses. He immediately fell on his face and began to repent and make teshuva and confess his sin before Hashem. So the rabbis are talking about this verse, and it says, David said before the Holy One, blessed is he, I have overcome my evil inclination, and I have done penance before you. If you accept me through my penance, then I shall know that Solomon, my son, will arise and build the temple, and that he will build the altar and burn on it all the offerings mentioned in the Torah. This connection can be derived from the verse, the sacrifices God desires are a broken spirit, a broken heart, and a humbled heart, O God, you will not despise. Another sage said, from where is it derived that with regard to one who repents, it is considered as if he ascended to Jerusalem, built the temple, built the altar, offered on it all the offerings mentioned in the Torah. Where can we find that to be true? And it's derived from this verse, the sacrifices of God that God desires are a broken spirit, a broken and humbled heart, O God, you will not despise. In other words, the sages said, if you make teshuvah, if you come before God with humility and brokenness, then it will be as if you yourself built the temple, built the altar, and put every offering on it. The sages go on to say here in the Midrash Shabbat, and they said, the Holy One, blessed be He, invalidated in regard to an offering of an animal. He invalidated in regard to a person. Let me read that again. All that the Holy One, blessed be He, invalidated in regard to an offering of an animal, He validated in regard to a person. That is to say, He invalidated in an animal one that is blind or broken or that has a split eyelid or even a wart. But He validated in regard to a person, one who has a heart broken and humble. Rabbi Alexandri said, if a commoner were to use a broken utensil, it would be considered a matter of disgrace. It would be considered a matter of disgrace for him, but the Holy One, blessed be He, the utensils that He desires are broken utensils. As the scripture says, Adonai is close to the brokenhearted. He is the healer of the brokenhearted. For thus says the exalted and lifted one, I abide in exaltedness and holiness, but I am with the despondent and lowly in spirit. And the sacrifices of God that He desires are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite and humbled heart, O God, you will no wise cast out. You know, it's interesting. We're talking about keeping the fire going, and we're entering into this season of preparation for Passover. And how do we really prepare? We got to humble our hearts and break our hearts for Hashem. Amen. You know, the Midrash Shabbat, I don't have time to read the entire passage, but the Midrash Shabbat says something interesting. It realizes that when the Torah is talking about the fire on the altar, it says that you shall keep the wood to make to keep a flame burning on it. But the word that's used in the Torah is actually the word bo. Here it is right here. Al hamizbeach kol halayla ad haboker ve'esh hamizbeach tukat bo. That on the altar all night until the morning, and the fire of the altar should be kept aflame on it. But the rabbis point out and say that the word is not it. The word is in it. So it's like this, going back to being the burning bush. Let's talk about the burning bush in the last few minutes we have here for a second. The burning bush was a bush, a thorn bush, the rabbis agree. It was on fire but not being consumed. And that in the middle of the bush was Yeshua. It says the angel of the Hashem was in the middle of the bush and God spoke from the middle of the bush. And so what the rabbis point out here in the Midrash Rabbah is that, look, the text says that the fire is supposed to be in it. It says for nearly 116 years, the fire was aflame on the altar. But nevertheless, the wood never burned up and its copper never melted. Why is that? To make a long story short, because the reading of the Hebrew literally means that the altar itself provided the fire. Fire did not emanate from the wood, it emanated from the altar. And as a result, they put fresh wood on it every morning, but the wood was always there. In other words, the altar literally was a bush that was aflame that never got consumed. And the source of the fire came from the altar itself. Oh, come on. Some of y'all look at me like, I don't even know what you're saying. I don't know how to react to that. The reaction is this. That we are going to be and should be and are now burning bushes, and the fire comes not from us but from the altar that makes us the burning bush. But we're still required to put wood on the fire every morning. You say, but it doesn't God like... Yeah, see, here's the beautiful thing. God expects us to partner with Him. We've got to get up every morning and put a log on the fire. Can't you see the priest? They get up every morning and say, hey, Yochanan, throw a log on the fire. Well, the wood we put on yesterday isn't burned up yet. Throw another log on the fire. It says this about the golden altar of incense as well. When the priest went into the golden altar of incense, it was the golden altar of incense that caused, it was the fire that emanated from that altar that caused the fragrance to go up. Listen, the reality is when we come to the altar of Hashem, it's that altar that causes the fire to burn in our spirits. And we're the wood. We've got to be faithful. We've got to be faithful to be the ones to put the wood on the fire every morning. And God is saying to us, if you will be diligent to follow me every day. This is why we say the Shema when we wake up and we say the Shema when we lie down. Every day, the morning and the evening, you keep this and then I will be faithful to keep that fire burning in your spirit all night long. You come back and you start the service all day. But whenever we miss, whenever we take a day off, that's when that flame starts to weaken. And then the enemy starts whispering to us and saying, oh, you don't have to do that. That's not for today. That wood, he doesn't really need your wood. You heard the rabbi, the fire comes from the altar, not the wood. Say, he doesn't really need your wood. Oh, no. Oh, no. The commandment to us is to keep the fire burning. He didn't say we're supposed to be concerned so much about how God keeps it burning, but we're supposed to do our part to keep it burning. So as we're getting ready for Pesach, we're still celebrating Purim. Let's remember in this season ahead that we're getting the chametz out, but we need to make a wood pile. And we need to keep that altar on fire. This is a time to renew the fire in our lives, to be kodesh, to be ignited with fire. And we can do that if we'll come to the altar of Hashem and put our emunah in Yeshua, who is the ultimate Olah Korban. Korban Olah. Amen.